This microphone's attached to my head. Here we go. Picks and bans. Jyn Air versus CJ. There's a LeBlanc ban first off, so Jyn Air not wanting to first pick that for GBM. He did play it once in their last series, but not going to do it in game one. There's a Rumble ban. Okay, so nobody gets Rumble. Fine. Shy's like, all right, fine. Nobody gets it.
Well, Shy always has that Shyvana to fall back on as well, which is a champion that is perfectly fine in the current meta. Not a lot of people playing it, but that pocket pick, a danger that you have to consider when you're playing against CJ. Rek'Sai, Chaser's jungle of choice, will be removed from the pool as well. And there's the Gragas ban.
Yeah, what do you think about that? I mean, Gragas is strong, no doubt about that. But would either one of these jungles really pick it? I don't know. I'm not so sure.
Chaser, they both played it. So if it's available, you can pick it. You do have some early presence on the map. I am surprised that Jyn Air banned it because Ambition has other options for early jungler. He can play that Nidalee. He can play that Lee Sin with a Warrior Enchant. Mm-hmm. So in a way, since Jyn Air has first pick, it's kind of taking a tool that they might have to match Ambition's early game.
All right, well,
away from them. Now, where are they going to go with this? Echo is open. Echo.
You know, if any region isn't going to pick up a champion right away after its release, it's going to be Korea. So it is possible that we just won't see the Echo today.
I think that's very unlikely.
We'll see. I hope I'm wrong. I hope I'm wrong. But if there's any region that's not going to do it, it's going to be Korea.
So Sivir will be the first pick. Obviously, yeah. They've seen CJ grabbing that in their last three games. And Captain Jack, of course, very good with that Sivir as well, and instrumental in some of Jyn Air's recent victories also. It's just such a good pick right now, and both teams have shown that priority, so they're going to test the waters, giving CJ a couple of picks over on that red side.
We've seen a little bit of Karma pop back up again to kind of combat the speed boost that Sivir gives your team. Do you think we'll have a chance to see that out of CJ? I don't know if Madlife is going to pick it up today.
I don't know if he will either, and the only player who's played Karma is Gorilla.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of waiting. I think it's a good pick. I'm kind of waiting for other players to try it out, but instead they may go for Madlife's Annie, a champion that he's had a lot of success and a lot of bans on, actually.
Yeah, and certainly a champion that can stop a heavy engage cold with that Tibra stun, too. So we'll see how that works out. Victor, still available, slipping through the bans, and it'd be a pretty solid pick for GBM. We'll see what he goes with. There's the Echo. Is he going to go with it? I want to see this, man. I want to see GBM play Echo. Brand I would be okay with too, but I think it's probably going to be the Victor. Yep, locks it in.
Has that good mobility with the Sivir. So pretty standard composition that Jyn Air is setting up so far. They've taken the Maokai away from Shy. So now Shy is actually going to have to play a champion that's not Rumble or Maokai.
And he could play the Ryze. I mean, Shy has had like hundreds of games on Ryze. It was one of his primary champions for a long time.
That's a really good point. Ryze falling shockingly far down the draft right here. Apparently, Jyn Air very confident that they're going to be able to contain Shy's Ryze. I would not be so confident in that fact.
We'll see. Could be that Hecarim pick as well. Corki pretty solid too.
The Hecarim pick is better against Victor than the Ryze will be.
That's
because
true.
When you have Annie, Evelynn, Hecarim, you have a million tools to get onto the Victor who has no movement ability. I mean, that Victor can just die instantly right now, so they're going to lock it in.
Yeah, a little bit of poke from that Corki, but man, the engage coming in from CJ should make GBM a little bit worried. So how do you combat that? Do you just go ahead and grab a Thresh or something like that? Jay is a great Thresh player.
I would honestly try Janna here.
Oh, okay.
I would go for Janna. You need something. You have your engage already with the Sivir and the Maokai. You have great setup. If you really want to go maximum engage and have GBM just throw his body into the enemy team, you could go for the Leona. But
his mechanical body is ready.
I think that Janna is a much safer choice in this circumstance. And then for the jungler, ooh.
I mean, Sejuani still available? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it wouldn't be bad. Another thing that stops the engage, and Nautilus can help as well a little bit. I kind of like the Thresh better than Nautilus, but you like the Janna. I mean, Chase play a lot of Nautilus, so the Nidalee would be a bit of a surprise, and it looks like that's what it's going to be. Wow.
Well, they have a lot of potential to actually damage CJ early on, especially their bottom lane's going to be pretty squishy right there, and Nidalee going to be picked up for Chaser, a champion he played earlier this season.
Oh, there it is.
Echo.
Echo for Coco. And so our first Echo of Korea. Wow, you're right. Very first game. Nobody wasting time. I wonder if that has ever happened before, that a champion, the first game it was available in Korea was picked. I don't think that's ever happened with a new champion before.
Yeah, it's definitely a rarity.
Yeah.
Here in this scene.
Yeah, I mean, usually Korea is always the one that waits a month or something before anyone picks it. But Echo just too strong right now to avoid. And Coco's going to try it out against GBM's Victor.
And Echo has been a bit of a mixed bag as players get used to him and teams get used to playing around him. And I'm very curious because CJ is a team that has a very strong identity as team fighters. But this is going to be a great pick. He's going to be able to easily get into the back line with that phase dive, get on top of Victor. And one of Nidalee's flaws is if you are playing an engaged team with a Nidalee, it doesn't really fit into Jin Air's composition because you want Nidalee to poke over time. But Nidalee is pretty useless in hard engaged team fights like the one CJ's bringing to the table. She pretty much just has to run around in circles and try not to die.
Man, CJ has a great potential to chain some serious CC as well between all the ults
and
then parallel convergence from Echo. Yeah, it's pretty massive. So if CJ catches you, you're basically not going to go anywhere. You're going to die.
I really like CJ's draft this game.
Well, let's see if it pays off. Game one, Jin Air versus CJ. It's go time. And here we go. Welcome to Summoner's Rift. Jin Air Green Wings. Oh, CJ fans really, really winning that one. Jin Air, I don't know, man.
Get it together, Jin Air fans.
Yeah, come on, Jin Air fans. Figure it out. Stumbling it up for Mad Life right away. They want to be ready to catch someone as they do this five-man invade, getting some deep wards in.
Yeah, it looks like they are going to be wrapping around early. Trace is going to have to fall back up into the top side of the map. So, I mean, CJ has so many flank options right here. They've got a lot of mobility. They have that hard engage with Annie. They're looking really, really good. They can come in from so many different angles. They can come from the front with the Annie, coming from the sides with the Evelynn and the Hecarim, that I'm very worried about GBM's Victor and Chaser's Nidalee here. They have to have extremely good flank wards, and sure, they can get some good poke in with the Victor E and the spear from Nidalee, but I'm just not sure they're going to be able to poke long enough with how many ways CJ has to engage before to do the sufficient amount of necessary damage. It's really risky. I think CJ's comp is really versatile and has that great dive into the backline. It's going to come down to how well GBM can position here and how well his team can ward for them to prevent these very deadly flanks from coming in from CJ.
Yeah. Do you think maybe the Corki would have been a better pick for Jin Air since it would have provided them a little bit more poke? They were going to go with the Nidalee anyway.
No, you want to take that Sivir away. The Sivir gives you disengage as well.
Well, CJ's been prioritizing Sivir quite a bit. I mean, a lot of teams have, but especially Space.
I mean, if CJ had also gotten the Sivir with this composition, it would have been an absolute nightmare for Jin Air. And Sivir is still very useful for them for collapsing or just for kiting out with this Nidalee and with this Victor. So Jin Air is going to have to be very focused on how they kite in this game. And again, just keep that vision up on their flanks. It is so crucial to how these team fights are going to play out.
True enough. I wonder, as we see the teleport used for Trace to get back in the lane really quick, I wonder how aggressive Coco is going to be with this Echo in the mid lane. You know, are we going to see the all-ins, perhaps? And when are they going to come? He's got Ignite. He does want to be aggressive. And we've all seen the bursts that Echo can do.
Indeed. Well, Chaser, he's only had one game this season on Nidalee, so that statistic, a little bit misleading.
A blue steal there for Jin Air.
Yeah, little lane swaps. They're just doing vertical jungling right now, so they're able to take each other's blue buffs. Trace just falling back right there. Can't really get close to the wave, but he does see the Evelynn, I believe, coming out of the tri-brush. And then now we have the teleport for Shy into the bottom lane, starting to get his first few creeps. Mad Life already there to back him up as well.
You know, what I've discovered so far with Echo is that His W from the brush when you don't see it coming is one of the most terrifying things in the entire world, because then he just dashes in and stuns you and just destroys you.
Yeah, nice 2.25 second stun there. No problem.
That's pretty good. Just get that passive proc, you know. It's a tiny bit of burst. Just a tiny bit.
Just a little.
Yeah.
All right, so Ambition looking for a gank right here. Has those double buffs, but he's going to get seen by Trace, W'd on immediately.
Yeah, knocked back by that arcane smash. So Trace taking some damage, but able to get out without having to burn his flash or anything like that. What about this bot lane? Obviously a lot of early pressure from Captain Jack and Shay, but if Space and Madlife just kind of wait it out, they're going to have some pretty good fights later on if Ambition shows up post six.
Indeed they will. So Koga just pulling the minion wave over, going to reset it a little bit closer to his tower. That's just a cute trick. Mm-hmm. With only one minion left, kind of milking every advantage out of the minion situation in the mid lane. And GBM happy just to sit back and farm with his death ray right now. Doesn't want to push too far forward, but Chaser's got to start doing something here. You've got to get an edge with this Nidalee.
Yeah, we'll see. I mean, right now there's only a ward covering bot lane for Coco, so Chaser could potentially come down and try to start something. We'll see. Playing back far enough that he shouldn't have a whole lot to worry about, though.
Yeah, looks like we're in for a pretty passive lane swap here. Both sides just freezing a little bit. Trace getting a small CS advantage, but nothing really to write home about, and he's going to probably lose it as he has to walk back into his lane at the moment after his first buy.
I think anyone would write home about a CS advantage, be like, dear mother, today I maintained a 7 CS advantage in top lane for 15 minutes.
Well, the pro players certainly should tell their parents what they're up to. So
that's true, yes. I suppose. Yeah. Be proud of that CS advantage.
That's a real accomplishment as a professional LoL player.
That's true, be like, today was a wonderful day. I hit the flame horizon.
That's what they like to write. Like, yeah. Dear mom, I hit the flame horizon today in my game, and I won MVP. I'm the greatest.
And send it as a handwritten letter through the mail, so you know, so they know you care. You know, it just shows more effort. Well, Ambition may find Chaser here in the jungle. He will, doing a little bit of damage. Chaser has that flash if he needs to get out. He can always hop to flash over the wall. Madlife comes in and first blood. Taken by Ambition. Nice response by Madlife to get up there. Flash over the wall with that stun available. Great play from CJ.
Yeah, Chaser really didn't think that Madlife was going to commit for the flash like that. But
oh, you don't know Madlife if you don't think he's going to commit for kills.
It's very true.
Yeah.
It's very true. Good play by Madlife. Chaser, though, you know, playing a bit risky. He thought that he was going to be okay because he had pushed up that lane. But the fact is that they had a ward on that Gromp earlier on. So they were going to know whether this Evelynn was there or not. And instead of playing it safe, in fact, instead of even doing something like hopping over the blue wall, actually choosing to go to the river gave Madlife that angle. So kind of lazy decision making there by Chaser, actually.
Yeah, well, like you said, I just don't think he thought Madlife was going to go all in on that one. But hey, a flash for a first blood and an assist, that's not bad. Not bad at all. And Madlife is starting to roam a little bit more with that Annie now that Shy is going back into the jungle for a little bit more farming. He's got time to move around. And this is where that Annie gets really dangerous on Madlife. It's his ability to just kind of pop out and stun you.
Yeah, we saw so many bans of Madlife's Annie last season. He really did justify the pickup in a lot of ways. And now he's back again.
Well, W used by Coco. Couldn't quite catch GBM. It's a tough one to land, man. It takes like 3 seconds to get there, so it's a challenge.
It is.
Yeah.
But its range is pretty ridiculous, so
yeah.
I actually think that its range is part of the problem with it, because it's like you have no way to know that it's coming because of how far off-screen you can actually cast it and have it be relevant within a team fight.
Well, that's definitely true. Yeah, like I mentioned earlier, man, that W from Echo is terrifying if you don't see it coming. Suddenly it's just there, and then you're not.
Oh, no, you're there. You're just frozen in time.
You're there, but you can't control your character. Your screen is all gray, and you've got this like counter going on. You can buy stuff, but that's about it. It's much less fun.
That's just the shopping mode that every character has now.
That's right. It's the shopping passive.
You activate the shopping passive.
Able to shop while dead. Wow, what a great passive.
I'm sure Adam Smith is just really, really happy with the ability to shop while dead. It's like his dream.
I'm just worried about the power creep if you can shop while dead, you know? All the new champions could shop while dead, Monty. I don't know. Well, Mad Life threw the stun onto Che, but not a lot of follow-up here. A little bit of damage coming in. Yep. And did they get that blue buff over to Coco, or was that already gone? I didn't catch it.
Yeah, they got it over to Coco, I believe.
And now Chaser and GBM going to sneak their way in.
They want to take out the Eve. They think she's actually on the Wolves right now, but trying to set up a gank at the bottom lane instead, so it looks like Che will provide some protection while Chaser counter jungles.
CJ may be catching people. Coco, though, out of position, though. Yeah, and so Jhinair is able to kind of just set up in the CJ jungle for now. Take this Rift Scuttler as well.
Yeah, they learned from their previous mistake. Now Che also in the jungle to protect against wayward Mad Lifes.
Yep, take your support along. Going to be a slight little teleport advantage for Shy, it looks like. Oh, never mind. Wow. Meanwhile, Mad Life just dies. They caught him and took him out really fast.
The revenge
ended up going
of
to Chaser. No kidding. He flashed for it, too. He's like, fine. Multiple flashes used, actually, but it looks like they're going to be able to claim a dragon off of it as well, too. So Jhinair, yeah, coming back, getting the kill, going and grabbing the first dragon of the game as well.
Yep, so they actually are able to transition a kill into an objective, so very close early game that we have right now as they finally are able to discover that Evelyn. So Mad Life is there recalling. Mad Life is going to be grabbed and destroyed, and that is the burst that you get from that Evelyn in the mix. Maybe a little bit of an overcommittal right there. Captain Jack probably didn't have to flash an ult for that one. That was
yeah, I mean, between the damage coming in from Chaser, well, Chaser's spear hit like max range, so they didn't really need Sivir there at all. At least he got the assist, you know? It's all about the assist.
I guess. I suppose that's a point you could make, is that at least he got the assist. Could have done that with just his ult without actually flashing, though.
It's a silver lining, man.
I don't know if there is a silver lining to your flash being down.
You got the assist. See, silver lining isn't like a great thing about a bad situation. It's like an okay thing.
He could have gotten the assist just with using his ult but not flashing.
I suppose. But since it was a bad situation, that's what makes there be a silver lining to begin with. You can't have a silver lining in a good situation. Oh, Jay, not a good situation for him as well. Stun from W doesn't hit, but it doesn't matter. Coco claims his first kill with a little bit of help.
Ah, Shy. Also in the bottom side right here now, just pushing up, starting to proxy farm. They want to get this kill onto Captain Jack. Chaser is coming, but he's not there yet.
Yeah, they're going to knock him right back in the W. They get the stun, and Captain Jack gets taken out. Another kill for Coco. Shy, though, going to go down. Yep, Chaser able to grab one there, but now he's just going to get dove. I don't know if that was the best idea. It looks like they're going to leave him. Nope, you got to kill that. Yeah, there we go. All right, Ambition grabs one. Chaser's like, I want to die too. Okay.
But he killed Shy, so worth, though.
Worth. All caps. Type it out. Worth.
Yeah, they're going to lose the tower as well. So Jhinair just kind of filing in one by one to their doom. It was a good play from CJ. Go in on the map right there. Get the deep wards in, and they laid a nice trap that caught Che out, and then that just snowballed into the Sivir being alone on the bottom side. So a good continuation of events for CJ, and then they kept collapsing even after Shy met his end at the end of an Italy Sphere.
Yep. Met his end, literally. Maybe not quite literally. You know what I mean? It was like a spear pun. It didn't really work. I don't know. Forget about that. Let's talk about Coco's items. He's got the Marilla Namakon now and a Blasting Wand, so a little bit extra damage there. He's quite a bit more powerful than GBM at the moment. Yeah. Has GBM been back to buy, though? I don't think
he
has.
Yeah, he's upgraded his Void Core.
Oh, you're right.
Or his Hextech Core, whatever it's called.
Hextech Core? If Kassadin had an item, it would be the Void Core.
Look, I mean, they just invent words. And then
well, that's what you do in a fantasy universe. You have to invent words. You can't have, like, extraordinary things in a fantasy universe and call them normal names.
I like Victor Scepter.
Victor Scepter?
Yep.
That's boring. I'm glad you're not naming things in League of Legends, Monte Cristo. Captain Jack manages to take the bot lane turret. The middle lane is very, very low as well. GBM is going to be able to knock that down fairly soon. Oh, Tried to land that.
Hey, at least Scepter is somewhat creative. I could have just called it Victor Stick.
Victor Stick. That's even better. I like that one better, actually. The Victor Stick. It's not magical. It's not a magic stick, but it is the technology stick.
Who the hell knows?
I don't know. Tech staff. That sounds cool. That's probably already used in the game, though. I would imagine.
All right, well, it looks like Jin Air is actually starting to group right now. Oh, and right as I say that, they're going to recall. They don't have a lot of HP left. One of the advantages that Jin Air did get off of that those ganks in the bottom lane was that GBM put a ton of chip damage onto the mid turret, and it is almost down already.
True.
So as long as they can keep pushing up right there, keep getting that advantage, maybe they can turn something out. Meanwhile, Trace has gotten a little CS lead on the top side, but Captain Jack has fallen a bit behind in lane after dying under that turret and being denied a bunch of CS.
I mean, the other thing, too, is that with, looks like they might take out mid lane here, with Shy having that smite, you know, having that Skirmisher Saber, a lot of his CS is worth more, too. Because he did get a little bit of time to farm in the jungle in the bottom side of the map and stuff. So, yeah, as we can see, the gold really about 500 behind. Okay, so that's not quite as close as I thought it was going to be, but.
Yeah.
So never mind.
Well, there you go. But in spite of the kill differential, we still do see that near parity in terms of gold.
Yeah.
And what's going to happen with this next dragon? Jack is feverishly putting up the pushing up the bottom side. Jin Air, it would be fantastic if they were able to take out that mid turret before this next dragon came up.
It'd help a lot. And CJ knows that. You know, they've got Space and Mad Life in the mid lane now to try to push things back a bit. Coco rotating down to bot, and he's almost done with that Abyssal Scepter, too.
Yeah, GBM has to go back right now. He's got a lot of money in his pocket, going to grab a needlessly large rod. So a bit different than some of the other Victor builds that we've been seeing, actually.
Well, I think with the dragon fight coming up, he just wants as much power as he can right now, you know?
Yeah, but not a lot of mana for sustained poke here, which is a bit worrisome because that's kind of what they want to rely on with Chaser's Nidalee as well. Hmm. So not having that extra mana may prove problematic if he has to go into a sustained poke mode around this dragon. Okay. Still no Infinity Edge either for Captain Jack, so this isn't a great fight, I think, for Jin Air, just in terms of itemization.
Well, yeah, Space has his Trinity Force already. Coco's got a couple kills, looking a bit stronger. Shy and Ambition have their early items as well, so it would be a little bit tough. I mean, Jin Air can try to poke people out, but as far as a big 5-on-5 fight, I don't know if I'd want to try it in their position.
Yeah, that Annie is just so threatening right now as well. I think maybe you just see if you can get the poke, and if not, go ahead and give it up and try and just trade it for a mid lane turret.
Okay, just going to sweep out that ward. Oh, that spear completely missed.
Well,
he tried. It was blind.
Was blind after the sweeper went down. So, nice attempt.
Although if he was aiming at the dragon, that's pretty sad. The dragon doesn't move, guys. He's pretty much in the same place all the time.
No, I think he was trying to estimate where Annie would be autoing from. But Mad Life was in a weird place because he wasn't using his range. Now they're going to go ahead. They're going to see that the dragon is being taken, but Jin Air not really in a position to do much of anything right now. No TPs. They're just going to let it go.
Oh, flash stun on Captain Jack, though. They catch him. Captain Jack very low, has to ult and flash away. They get some knockups in response. Shy teleporting down. And CJ doesn't look like they're going to turn this into any kills, but they did get the flash out of Captain Jack. Looks like they may lose their mid lane turret, getting very, very low, but they'll save it for now.
Oh, wow. So that mid laner just barely staying up. We'll see what kind of siege that Jin Air can mount, but not a lot of mana on Chaser right now. And they have to use some of their abilities to go ahead and clear this wave. Shy going to catch a wave in the top side in the meantime. Yeah, I think they're just going to have to back off this.
Yeah, CJ really committing to saving this mid-late turret for the moment anyway, but looks like they're going to end up giving it up at some point.
Yeah, it's just that Chaser's damage isn't quite there yet. He's working up to that Seraph's Embrace, but even that poke, pretty minor.
Yeah.
As we saw in Coco. Coco does have the Negatron cloak, though, so he knows that this is a very AP-heavy team that Jyn Air is running, and he's itemizing accordingly.
Yeah, that Abyssal Scepter is going to help out quite a bit. It actually benefits Corki a little bit, too, even.
Indeed it does. So you've got some decent synergy going on right there. Space getting a Vamp Scepter. We're getting another Longsword, so looks like...
Yeah, before getting boots, too.
Yeah, looks like he will be just going into Blade next. And trying to deal with the Maokai by shredding his HP in that capacity.
A bit surprising, though. I mean, usually you see those Sork shoes picked up by Corki for a second item.
Yeah, that is a bit odd, but... I guess he feels quite safe in this situation and like his team really isn't going to be setting up for the poke. I mean, there's not really anything else about this CJ Entis team composition that says poke. Corki's just going to need to get in and get auto attacks done instead. Now Trayson, Shy just going to do a little bit of trading in that bottom side.
Yep. Shy just using that challenging smite for the moment just to try to get that slightly better trade, but they're pretty even up right now overall. Here comes Ambition. I don't know if he's going to be able to catch anyone. Nope, they find the ward there.
Yeah, that's it. So, I mean, the Baron's going to spawn for the first time in 10 seconds. But CJ, I think, comfortable with their situation. They know that they have this great pick potential and that they're going to scale very well into the late game against what Jyn Air is bringing to the table. Again, they have so many opportunities to engage and to shut down GBM and Chaser that I think you just try and play passively and avoid the Nidalee for the moment and then just shut her down, make her that big non-factor later.
Right. Seems pretty reasonable. For now, a little bit of a lull in the action. That mid lane turret's still alive for CJ. I think Time Winder is a really cool ability. I think that's probably one of my favorite non-ultimate abilities to come out in a while.
Do you like it when people wind time?
I love it. I like time-related stuff in general. Time travel has always been one of my favorite concepts.
Yeah, it's
to be explored in gaming and stories and movies. And
it's so hard to do right, though, and almost every time it's done wrong.
Yep, that's because people can't stick to their own rules. All you got to do is decide your rules for time travel and then stick to it throughout whatever piece you have, and people don't do that.
It's so true. They really don't.
You'd think it'd be simple. But time travel's anything but simple, Monte Cristo. As I learned once long ago in the future.
You know what was so funny about Looper that made me laugh?
What's that?
I actually like Looper.
This is a fun movie.
Speaking of sticking to your own rules, ooh, no, Chaynot, actually. No one going in on that one.
Yeah.
But speaking of sticking to your own time travel rules.
Uh-huh.
So the whole premise of Looper is that the Loopers exist because you can't kill people in the future.
On the traditional sense, yeah.
Yeah, in the traditional sense. But then the entire plot device with Bruce Willis and his future character is about them killing his wife in the future, which apparently you couldn't do. So, I mean, the whole plot just kind of falls apart at that point.
Exactly. It's just, way too risky to just, straight up murder somebody in, a regular
sense. But then they just straight up murder?
But then they do it. Yeah.
What?
I don't know. It's all right, we'll go with you on this one. I don't know. Joseph Gordon-Levitt turns into Bruce Willis when he gets older? I don't know. Okay, sure. Why not? Yeah.
And here I was just hoping he would turn unemployed when he got older.
Whoa, zing! That was a good one. Wow. Oh, good gank onto Trace as well, too. He's dead. No, he's not dead. He's just gone for a few seconds. No, not going to catch anybody with that.
Just a lot of wave pushing and sieging right now, Doa. Don't get too excited. I mean, Trace
I'll
died,
try not
but
to.
It was on the bottom side of the map, and they're not really able to take any advantages out of this. They have that wave clear already in the mid lane with Victor and Sivir, so not a really good way for CJ to push in.
Mm-hmm. You know what my favorite time travel movie is?
Time Bandits? That's the only possible answer.
That's totally incorrect. Time Bandits is a great movie, but the best one ever was Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
Oh, damn, you got me. Okay.
That was a great movie. Because they stuck to their time travel rules. They did. They didn't. Their time travel rules, were very free and made, like, no sense, but they stuck to them.
Yeah.
It was great.
It is a great movie, I have to admit.
He, like, needs his dad's car keys, so he just, like, imagines himself leaving them there in the past. And then they just suddenly appear. I love it. Dragon suddenly appearing. Maybe not so suddenly. We knew he was coming. CJ takes it again. That's their second dragon now. MadLife just providing a bit of zoning.
And they're falling off the mid-turret at the same time, which is very interesting for Jhin Air that they would choose to give it up for a recall. Hmm. That means they really have to fight now and punish this. There's going to be a dive onto Captain Jack, though. Nice flash.
Yeah, CJ going with the fight there. Tippers didn't really accomplish a whole lot. And Shy teleporting down. Ambition trying to come in from behind. Gets blown up. Tries to escape here. Space having to flee as well. Not really getting a good position to go in on anybody here. They're going to go ahead and chase MadLife. An easy target there. Parallel Convergence comes in, but not catching anybody because Coco is nowhere to be seen.
Well, that buy actually proved very fruitful. So,
I guess so.
CJ really overcommitted. Now, when the Dragon was going down and they saw that that mid lane wasn't finished off, they should know that that was a mass recall from Jhin Air. Therefore, diving the Tier 2 turret right after the buy and the heal and the fact that they knew that everybody was in base, extremely dangerous, especially since that gold had just been turned into items for Jhin Air. So they were going to have an advantage in that way as well.
Right.
Really big overcommitment right there. Coco had to burn his ult just to get out of that situation, and then there really wasn't any follow-up. And now Jhin Air is finally going to get that Tier 1 in the mid lane, put themselves up at a 3-2 turret advantage and a slight gold edge as well.
It's a pretty close game, but Jhin Air's been able to slowly but surely just chip away the map control that CJ's had. And I mean, CJ, this Echo pick is cool, but it does look like they're a little bit, you know, understandably inexperienced as far as like making it work in team fights.
It is a tough champion to make work in team fights, but CJ just needs to commit to the flank engages right there. They're playing like they're more ahead than they actually are. What they need is just that good setup right now, that ability to make picks and not to overcommit on kills that they're not really going to be able to follow up on, especially when they don't know where everyone on Jhin Air is.
Yeah. So I wonder, I mean, how does CJ sort of dig themselves out of this little hole that they've found themselves in? Just make picks? What?
No, they can team fight later on. They should just farm up right now, see if they can get this mid lane turret down. If not, what CJ needs to do is play for flanks around Baron and Dragon. Just get that big teleport with the Hecarim, get the angle with Evelynn, and they'll be able to follow up on that with a really good Annie ult, and that's just going to be the end of Jhin Air if they do that. There's not really a way for Victor to deal with that as a champion. So they should be in pretty good position as long as their setup is good. But you want to fight around the Dragon and the Baron. They just don't have enough siege right now with all these melee champions to really put down any kind of meaningful siege with the wave clear that Jhin Air has on the Sivir and on the Victor.
You know, one thing we're really seeing too is that this W for Echo is so hard to hit against good players.
Yeah, Chaser actually had to get a QSS this early on just because of how afraid of the hard CC he is, especially from Annie. He knows that he could be bursted down instantly in a team fight, and that is a major, major danger. Mm-hmm. But this is one of those reasons why Nidalee just isn't that good in the current meta. If you can hit that power spike, you look amazing, but it's so small. And against the amount of hard engage in the current meta, it's more difficult to play poking or kiting champions. And Nidalee's just so squishy, especially when she comes out of the jungle, that her small amount of poke damage doesn't justify the danger of the fact that she just has to be in cougar form in teamfights, running away constantly, or else she just gets one shot.
Nobody wants that.
Nope, nobody wants to be one-shot. That is true. Except the one-shotter, perhaps.
The one-shot-y?
No, the one-shot-y definitely doesn't want to be one-shot.
That's right. Well, they don't have much of a choice if it's already happened. It's too late. They only have that gray screen again. They get the buying buff at that point. Buy anywhere?
Yeah, freezes time so you can buy. You know, you don't have to worry about your character.
Nice.
The shopping buff.
He'll get back to base eventually. It's not a problem. CJ coming into the river here. Riftscuttler does go over to Jhin Air, though.
Yeah, just trying to keep vision on that objective right now, and that means that CJ has one less way that they can actually get these flanks. They can't bait that Baron very efficiently any longer. Coco just still trying to split push right now. No sign of a Lich Bane yet, surprisingly. That's one of the better items on Echo. And he delayed that Zhonya's as well. I think Zhonya's Lich Bane is really pretty core to how Echo operates, but yeah, decided to go for that Abyssal instead. And I think under these circumstances where he knows that CJ should know and Coco should know that the only way that they probably lose late-game teamfights is to being poked out first, well, why not just get that MR and take that little bit of a win condition away?
Echo's such an interesting champion, too, because you can't really engage in a sort of a traditional way with him. As CJ, ooh, they nearly take that mid lane turret, but you know, you can't use his ult to sort of move forward towards people unless you've already been there, right? So it's a bit counterintuitive that you have to sort of like get them to walk onto where it is, you know, or get people not pay attention in a team fight and walk onto where your former self exists.
The way you get around that, Doa, is that you go into a team fight and then you immediately Zhonya's, which buys you 2 seconds off your 4 seconds.
Right. Oh, Ambition coming in, ulting everybody. He's going to get jumped on, though. Madlife getting into the fray as well. Doesn't really get the best stun. Shy with a nice ult lined up. Oh, but he misses everything. They spread out just in time. Meanwhile, Space in the back lines getting focused down by Trace a little bit. Coco has to duck out of the fight. Doesn't get a whole lot of damage on. Madlife flashes in for the stun. Lands it, but no real follow-up. CJ getting taken apart here. Madlife down. Space going to get jumped on. Valkyrie's away here. Coco still in the fight for now, but he can't really engage right now. They're going to chase Ambition,
nice,
and that's a nice
GBM
snipe. GBM catching Coco there. Spear barely misses Madlife, and CJ on the run now. That did not work at all. Jhin Air did a great job of kiting that fight.
Well, CJ's not setting up any flanks. That's the big problem right now, is they're trying to really engage head-on. And Jhin Air was able to kite back into that choke, put the gravity field in the choke, and CJ just kept on piling in.
Yep.
Very difficult fight to win under those circumstances.
Oh,
CJ's going to re-engage with Shy.
Yeah, Shy coming down with that teleport. People still low on Jhin Air. GBM still manages to pick up on a kill onto Space before anything is done. Dragon does go to Jhin Air. Shy on his own. 1v4, no kills for him. Another one for Chaser and Jhin Air. They take the Dragon, they take the fight, they take care of the re-engage, suddenly jumping out to a pretty decent lead in this game.
GBM is playing really well this game on the Victor. I mean, yeah, picking up on that positioning from Corki and just going all in. So let's take a look at this again. Look at this. There is no flank right here. They just kind of all come in. Coco gets the flank by, but at that time, look, they cut off Shy and Coco from the rest of the composition with the gravity field. He's sitting in that Chaos Storm. Coco ults immediately just to get some health back. But Madlife tries for the flash W, but everyone just has to pour into that choke point. Space really reluctant for obvious reasons to walk into that position, and then has to go back over the wall afterwards, Ambition on his way out. But that's not the way you play this composition from CJ. They need to get better wards down so that they would actually have the opportunity to flank without piling in through a choke point and taking obscene amounts of damage.
Yeah, Jhin Air's actually been the team that's had very good warding this game, able to prevent themselves from being flanked, and it's been pretty important so far.
Well, that was one of their big win conditions, and if we take
Are they going to go in on this one? Thought about it.
If we take a look at the wards from that last fight, notice that they had pink wards on both of their flanks as they kited back into the choke. Just great map play from Jhin Air, really knowing what they needed to do to take the game.
Yeah, taking a turret lead as well after it. A lot of action over towards Baron, but Trace has that teleport advantage, so he can put the pressure on in the bot lane. Shy coming down to deal with it. But there's a teleport coming in for Trace. Are they going to find an opportunity here on CJ? Trace trying to come in from the flank. It's slowed, though, by Coco, and doesn't look like they're going to engage. No, he's going to ult and go in. Actually, Madlife turning around, and that Space gets grabbed by the dredge line, gets taken out by Captain Jack. They lose their support, though. Coco coming into the fight, but Jhin Air already way ahead in this team fight. Trace comes in for a little bit of a parting. Swiss advance. Here comes Coco trying to make a play. Couldn't quite catch Captain Jack. GBM gets a kill, though, again. On to Madlife. Coco comes in. Oh, he misses the Timewinder, not getting the slow on to Chaser. Can he chase him down? Chaser, it's hard to catch in Italy.
And he lost vision in that brush right there as well, so he couldn't follow up on the other part of the phase dive. Now he's going in again. Trace is going to W him right there. There's an Arcane Smash, but
he's so tanky, but not tanky enough.
Coco's going to go in and pick up the kill, actually. Zonya's Hourglass.
Indeed, Captain Jack waiting for those blades. Coco very, very low, and Shy gets him. They take out Coco, but a double kill for Captain Jack before it's all said and done. This game is turning into quite the brawl, isn't it? Wow.
That team fight went from all the way from CJ's red buff to Jin Air's inhibitor turret.
It did.
When the Tier 2, I mean, what a wacky fight that was. Tier 2 still up in that circumstance as well. So let's take a look at how this fight starts. I mean, Space just gets ulted right there. Che already committing a lot of cooldowns for him. And there's Chaser and Che just going to finish Space off. Now, Captain Jack and GBM in, trying to kite back in that choke point, putting down the gravity field. But then Jin Air just way overcommits right here. You have to be happy with that one for one, because when you start diving the turret like Trace did, everyone from Jin Air has to filter through that brush, and that set up an opportunity for Coco to go in and get those 1v1 skirmishes that he was really looking for in the back line.
Captain Jack did a really good job that fight too of spell shielding the W from Echo so he didn't get stunned. And that helped him escape and led to a double kill for him at the end. Trace may be overcommitting a little bit there.
Coco just going to come in with a phase dive to get the Zonya's Hourglass. And then Captain Jack's going to get a double kill off of this, though. Spell shield right at the end right there. And then baits Shy underneath the turret. So bit of overcommitment from both sides in both those last two team fights. Jin Air definitely shouldn't have tried to go under the Tier 2 like that in the previous fight. CJ tried to just funnel through that ramp right at Dragon, which made things rather awkward for them.
I mean, that's been CJ's problem with team fights the whole game, you know, trying to go through these choke points instead of trying to make a flank or something like that.
Chaser has Luden's Echo now.
Wow. All right. Well, the poke is real, right?
Definitely getting a lot of money this game, but we're in 35 minutes now, so somewhat expected. GBM starting to try and get that Zonya's Hourglass just so that he has more survivability against the backline dive. Probably a smart choice at this juncture.
I would say so. Jin Air able to get a pretty decent hold of the Baron area and the Riverside anyway for now. And this game, honestly, is still pretty close.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Nobody but having a big
vision,
edge.
The vision is so much in favor of Jin Air. I mean, we look at the map right now and just a couple more pink wards so far, a lot more green wards in favor of the Jin Air Green Wings. I mean, they have four warding totems this game, and that's the right choice. Why you buy warding totems with Jin Air's composition is you want to watch out for those flanks. You want to just like litter the map in wards so that you know when you have to start kiting. Mm-hmm. It's really the critical factor.
CJ coming down and taking out some of Jin Air's wards near the Baron pit.
I mean, Trace doesn't have TP right now and Shy does. There's a very legitimate threat of a Baron, but there's so many wards around the Baron already, great setup from Jin Air, that they can still somewhat safely split push, and there's an engage.
Yeah, Shy waiting to see if he needs to teleport in. He is. He's coming from behind. Here is the flank CJ wanted. He's going to come right over the wall with the ultimate. Doesn't need to, just turns right around it. Goes in. Shy actually ulting away. Coco doing a bit of damage here, but Shy deciding he didn't find the right angle to engage on this team. Meanwhile, Trace happy to engage. There's a dredge line. They take out Shy as well, too. Chaser in the back lines helping GBM pick up that kill, and now CJ pushing Jin Air back a little bit. But Jin Air in a pretty organized retreat at the moment.
Really poor engage again from CJ. That was a reactive engage to Ambition getting poked out right there. But again, they couldn't get the right flank. Shy was just running around, not able to get into the back line because he didn't have that clear angle, and he was unable to commit to using his ultimate over the wall, so
it just didn't look decisive by Shy, right? He came in, I thought he was going to get a big ult jumping over the wall, he just didn't do it.
It was so reactive to the poke on Ambition. That's the thing, is that they were like, oh crap, Ambition's at half HP, we just have to go now. Otherwise, we're just going to continue to get poked, but the kiting from the Sivir ultimate, definitely the strength that Jin Air needed. Now, they're not going to go for the Baron right now, not even going to start it. That's a bit questionable. Shy was back at base. Shy doesn't have teleport. I feel like they could have made a bait play right there.
Could have tried. GBM with a decent amount of money to spend when he gets back, probably. See what he picks up.
GBM actually going for the Furor enchantments as well. So really looking to kite with his auto attacks, assuming that there's going to be somebody within range so that he can continue to get those speed boosts. I think it's a great pickup against the composition that CJ is running, where you only really have that initial gap closer of a Hecarim ultimate, and after that, Eve and Hecarim are both very kiteable.
That makes sense. So now, Generic can just sort of push lanes up a little bit, be patient. And if you're Generic, kind of, patience seems to be the name of the game right now, you know?
It certainly is. They've had every opportunity in these team fights. They've gotten their way most of the time because CJ just doesn't seem to know how to flank properly. That said, if CJ figures it out, okay.
All down to Ambition. Are they going to go in? GBM lays down a lot of damage. Madlife blows up immediately. Coco over the wall tries to get onto GBM. GBM Zonya's immediately. Trace comes back from the back lines after disrupting things quite nicely. Coco has to escape here. Captain Jack not caught in the W from Echo. Coco throws that Time Wander in, but doesn't get a lot done with it. CJ on the run again. Flash Dredgeline dodged by Space's Valkyrie. Trace comes in again. Ambition getting very, very low. Jin Air, though, again, kiting this extremely well, using the tankiness of Trace to let things like Chaser get in and just blow up Shy. There's a kill coming in for Captain Jack as well. Another one comes in for Jin Air, and CJ just destroyed in this team fight yet again.
Well, just a great catch right there. So they get the ult down onto Ambition. Ambition starts running, but Madlife uses Timbers, and it does nothing effectively, and then he just dies immediately, so turning that into a 5v4. And eventually, Jin Air is able to follow up on that fight. They blow a couple summoner spells, but they keep on the pursuit, and they catch Ambition out once again. Trace with that twisted advance play to continue the team fight and get it rolling 5v4 for Jin Air, and that's a Baron for the Green Wings. Now, taking a look at the remainder of that fight, Ambition gets caught out again with the W, and they start chasing. But look at this. GBM still has his ultimate up, drops it when CJ isn't expecting it on three members, gets a lot of work done, and then Coco pretty much just soloed out by GBM in the back line, Trace with the late route to help out.
Yep, and I feel like we're kind of seeing more of the same from CJ in general. You know, they're on their way to losing yet another game one.
Yeah, well, the fans in Korea joke that it's their rage bar filling so they can get vengeance in the next two games. They have to lose that first game. They tend to look very disjointed, like they don't really know how to play their team compositions. We're seeing that again here today.
It's kind of like that fight with Princess Bride where after the first game, CJ's like, you know what, I'm not left-handed. We'll see if they can do that today, though. Hard to predict the CJ team. Jin Air, though, looking like they might be cruising to an inhibitor here with that Baron buff. Coco trying to come in from the side, but again, just no real flank opportunities for CJ. Now that inhibitor in jeopardy, and I think it's going to go down. Yep, there it goes.
This game has just been a real lack of coordination on CJ's part. It's not that hard. You only need one of Hecarim or Evelynn to get the flank, but neither of them has been able to find it. And to Jin Air's credit, one thing that we can talk about since these rosters have reformed, since we've seen at the beginning of Season 5, Jin Air come together with this new roster. If we think back to how Jin Air played in the early part of spring when they were looking very strong, was that they were playing these kite compositions with Xerath. And that is one thing that Jin Air is super good at. And they were so capable of denying vision on their flanks. That is one of Jin Air's big skills, is the denial of vision on the flank. And that prevented a lot of teams from ever being able to find those engages. If you don't have the wards, what are you going to do?
Yeah, I suppose you can kind of treat the Victor in the same way, where he's not, the most mobile champion in the world. You do need to protect those flanks. And certainly a lot more effective right now than Xerath. Oh, Trace coming in with the home guard. CJ on the run already. Ambition gets jumped on. Captain Jack right there to pile on the damage. Madlife has a stun laid up. Gets two of them with Tibbers, but that is not enough. CJ still has to back off.
Yeah, they do have that luxury of having the fountain right there, however. How much is Jin Air really going to be able to get done? Looks like Shy
quite a
not
bit.
Quite back. Yeah, it looks like they're going to nearly take the turret out. Parallel Convergence comes in. No one really hit by it, though.
Nobody's getting caught by that anytime soon. I wonder what the overall success rate of that hitting people is. So slow. I mean, it's good if you hit people, but man, at the pro level, I just don't feel like we're going to see that connect a lot of the time.
I'm going to save my judgment until I see Faker play Echo.
Okay, all right. Fair enough. Fair enough. But still. You need to kind of come in from a place they're not expecting. You know, you can't just lob it at them.
True.
If you see Echo in front of you and you see him start as W, and if you don't dodge that, there's something wrong.
That is true. So two inhibitors down now. Jin Air looking very good in this first game, doing a beautiful job of kiting out the composition from CJ.
Well, CJ wants this third dragon. Looks like they will get it here. Meanwhile, Jin Air wants to engage. They get the ult onto Ambition yet again. A lot of knockups coming out of that, actually. Coco looking for an opportunity to come back in. He could teleport back. Not desperate enough to do it, though. Shy already on the run, and oh, Coco in a lot of trouble here. W ults to get back up. Goes on to Chaser. A little bit of damage there.
Really nice escape.
Yeah, Coco able to use that utility from Echo to at least get out of the fight.
Yeah, planned his escape very well. Did have to pop his ultimate. Space and Ambition now on the turret. But one thing I love that Che has been doing every time this game is he instantly ults Ambition. As soon as he sees Ambition, Ambition gets ulted. And that means that Ambition has to run out, which absolutely ruins CJ's engage.
Yeah. It also leads to CJ having a couple members get knocked up as well, too, from that ult, because Ambition just kind of ducks behind people.
Methodical closure here from Jin Air.
Very.
Solid, solid game from them.
Yeah, not really anything remaining except for the Nexus turrets right now on the CJ side.
I really liked also that Jin Air was very patient when it came for dragons. Uh-oh,
yeah,
looks like we got
right.
Some action.
Bit of a fight, last-ditch effort by CJ. They get a nice ult from Shy. Captain Jack getting jumped on. Coco has to pop that Zonius right away, still below half health. Going to get out with his ultimate, but still too low to really come back in. Actually, he's okay. Jin Air, though, man, they can just kite these fights all day. Wow, Che comes in with another great Q. Gets a little bit low, though, and CJ might be able to just barely hold on. GBM doing everything he can to stop that from happening. Gets a double kill. Looks like he's going to be successful. There go the Nexus turrets, and Jin Air, despite the low health, despite Hecarim being up, are going to take game one. GG.
Yeah, very impressive individual performance from GBM as well on that victor, ending the game 9-1-6. But a lot of that was just the coordination of dewarding their flanks and setting up for the nice kite.
Yeah,
CJ's really got to get it together this next game and actually play their composition properly, because even though it was hard to do that against how well Jin Air was controlling vision, you still have to be able to find those flanks.
Yeah, it was a combination of just not having an angle to come in on, and then also Coco just never really found a way to make that Echo work. He cleaned up a couple kills early on. He got rolling well, but he just had no presence in the mid-late game.
Yeah, well, Chaser...
smoldering eyes of rage. That's pretty much what it is. So CJ versus Jin Air,
I think I
game number
easily
two.
See Darth Ambition.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Absolutely. Darth Madlife, too. I don't know about space. I don't know. How that worked. Darth Coco, Shy in space. I don't know if those guys could pull off the whole Sith thing. They could be like TIE fighter pilots, maybe. You know.
That's a pretty lame downgrade.
I could picture. No, it's not. I could picture space flying a TIE bomber and like doing like somersaults and be like, woo! You know. Shy would fly a TIE interceptor, of course.
Well, there you go.
That's where I put them in the Imperial military. Now you know. Rumble and Grog is banned out by CJ, and Alistar banned out so far for Jin Air.
Yeah, Jin Air banning out Alistar on both sides right now, so they don't want to first pick it. I mean, Che wasn't prioritizing it like Sweet was before.
Right.
He seems to have replaced Sweet on the starting lineup, and Kalista will be the ban against Space, of course, so... where are we going from here? Is the Rek'Sai going to be banned by CJ one more time? Do they perhaps want to first pick it? I think you just stick with the same bans. The bans weren't the problem for CJ at all.
Yeah, it really was in-game implementation of their strategy that suffered.
So it'll be Sivir
instead.
Okay. They don't want to first pick the Sivir, which means they probably will first pick the Rek'Sai or maybe the Ryze. Again, Ryze surprisingly falling all the way through pick and ban in the last game. It didn't make sense with CJ's composition for them to take it.
I'll see what the final ban is for Jin Air. Would be nice to see Shy on that Ryze again, though, wouldn't it?
It would be fun, but and now that the Sivir's gone too, maybe they're going to actually chance it as a first pick. Hecarim banned. Well,
with
I don't think
Hecarim
that's a threat.
Yeah.
Shy really didn't play a very good Hecarim in the last game.
I don't know. I mean, it does leave Maokai open. And do they want to grab that first? Yeah, the Rek'Sai might be a little bit
The Rek'Sai makes a lot more sense.
Yeah.
And there we go. So will the Maokai be taken by Trace again? Will he try to repeat his MVP performance on that champion?
The nice thing for Jhin Air, too, as well, is that they can wait until the very end for that mid pick as well.
Yes, they can.
So they can wait for a while to pick Xerath. They don't have to pick Xerath
right
away.
Oh, God, please, Doa.
They can pick either Yasuo or Xerath in the very last rotation then.
Coco will play Cassiopeia to bait out GBM's top secret counter pick.
That's right.
It's not really that secret.
grabbing the Victor early, what do you think about this? He had such a good game on Victor, but is it a little bit risky still?
I think Victor is such a good power pick right now. We've seen players just absolutely go off on that champion. And if they don't, the problem for Jhin Air is if they don't take Victor now, Coco will definitely take Victor in the next round of the draft because he's going to have to blind pick anyway, and it's such a good champion at the moment.
Probably true.
But picking both the solo lanes early, bold. Very bold from Jhin Air because now they're giving away both counter picks to the blue side. And I mean, we could say see Coco play something like Ahri, which has been a popular pick into the Victor. Faker has responded with that Lich Bane build into Ahri, so there's been a bit of itemization adaptation from Faker's Victor, at the very least, to that matchup.
Yeah, true enough. Ahri would be a little bit more solid of a pick as well with Sivir out of the way, so an AD carry that's not able to just spell shield out of your charm.
True.
Or before your charm hits, rather. So I wonder, not going to be the Malzahar.
Could play Fizz.
Yeah. Fizz would work.
Still a flex pick, too. I would think that the Fizz would go in the mid lane against the Victor.
And the Nautilus as well, presumably for Madlife, although he could go to the top lane. Very unlikely, but
they want to put Che on something different. Now, Che may just respond by playing Annie here. That's definitely a big possibility. We could see Chaser play Echo in the jungle.
Yeah.
Also, so that's certainly up for grabs. I like the fact that Madlife's a good Nautilus player, and they're forcing Che out of his comfort zone a little bit because he just has been spamming Nautilus nonstop.
I would think you can just pick Thresh here, though. Is it really that uncomfortable? Che is a very notably good Thresh player.
Well, we'll see what he does. I think that with the current composition, they may just take Annie.
Could be.
For the big engage with Maokai, they would have two glories then, as well as the possibility of comboing a nice Tibber straight into a Chaos Storm.
I definitely wouldn't mind seeing that jungle Echo, but it looks like it might be the Nidalee again, and this time it's going to be the Janna for Captain Jack.
All right, so this is what I wanted them to pick last game, was the Janna with the Nidalee-Victor combo, and this time they're going to take it. So presumably, I would assume we're going to see perhaps a Corki out of Captain Jack last. But we'll wait. And they may just go heavier into the poke composition. Jhin Air did a very good job of playing this kind of composition last game, and CJ didn't seem to have answers. So who can blame them for picking it again?
True enough. Now, who do you go with if you're CJ, as far as your AD carry goes? Do you go with something really aggressive to try to just overcome the kite, or do you try to pick someone who can poke, maybe?
Well, they don't really know what's going on yet. I mean, the rest of their composition really isn't built around poking, and they're lacking engage right now, actually.
Well, they could just go for some skirmishing, I suppose, with the Vayne LeBlanc.
This would definitely turn into a pick comp. After these champions are locked in, they don't really have a lot of power. They don't even have a good 4-1 split with the Vayne, so this is pretty much a pick composition from CJ and Tiss right here. I'm not too thrilled with what they're showing. Some strong assassins, and we will see Chai on the top lane Fizz.
No, I wonder what they're going to pick for Captain Jack here as well, too, because there's not a lot of AD carry left. I think Lucian, yeah, probably the most viable option at the moment.
Yeah, just go for the bully lane if you're Captain Jack right now. Why not? You still have good poke with the Lucian, and you want to shut down this Vayne in the early game. I mean, the problem here for CJ, well, one among many, is that their wave clear in their side lanes is horrible. So if Jhin Air is able to set up in Siege early on and get the side lane towers down, it's going to be very difficult for CJ to stay in this. They have to just kind of win these skirmishes, win these duels, and get some picks.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember if we've seen Shy play Fizz in the top lane yet.
No.
I feel like we haven't.
No,
yeah.
We have not.
We have not. Okay, so, yeah, that's true too. So Shy's Fizz debut up in top lane. We'll see how that one goes as well. It's gonna be interesting. I mean, if Jin Erik gets separated, if CJ is able to find those isolated situations, they can certainly skirmish one-on-one. They can certainly get those picks. But Jin Erik seemed very, very well prepared vision-wise last game. And if they just kind of follow that same plan, I feel like a lot of the danger from CJ is eliminated already.
Yeah, and if they get into standard lanes here, I just don't know how CJ is going to keep their turrets up.
No, that too, yeah.
The Fizz has to use, the problem with Fizz is that he has to use his playful trickster to wave clear, and if he does that, you can dive him really easily. So it comes with some risk, and then there's Vayne. So lots of pressure in the lanes early for Jin Erik. They could just take over this game with global gold from turrets.
Well, it would be a pretty surprising 2-0 of CJ if Jin Erik was able to pull it off here, but compositionally, it's looking like a possibility. We'll see if they can handle it. CJ looking, of course, to tie things up. And there is precedent here. They've lost so many game ones this season, come back and won the last two games. Will they do it again here today against the Jin Erik Green Wings? The game is all loaded up, guys. It is time to get on the rift and see who takes it, CJ versus Jin Erik. Let's get in the game and find out. Alright, welcome to Summoner's Rift. CJ Entis versus the Jin Erik Green Wings. And the CJ fans again crushing the Jin Erik fans in terms of cheers.
I'm really worried about CJ this game. This draft is really wacky. They're going to have to get a pretty substantial early game lead. And a lot of this is going to be up to Ambition and how well he can gank and get these lanes rolling. They're going to put down some deep wards right now and try and farm up space on the Vayne, but remember, CJ, they do not have engage with this composition. Mm.
So you think CJ really wants a lane swap here? They want to stay out of the 2v2.
I wouldn't want to be in a Lucian Janna lane getting shot with Lightslinger in my face if I was space.
But Lightslinger in your face.
Lightslinger.
Lightslinger? That's what I said.
The Lightslinger is it's nice and ethereal as a
that's right. The Sona song,
yeah,
perhaps.
That's it.
Good save.
So, well, it looks like we are going to get the lane swap, actually. And okay. Trace setting up the sapling start for GBM, so he gets that slight experience edge with the death ray. So CJ should be looking to freeze, but having this Fizz, Shy, of course, going for that Cinder Hulk build on Fizz, which is becoming more popular. But I just don't know about this. I mean, sure, the Hecarim was banned, but Shyvana would have given them some more substantial engage in this game, and they really have nothing. Like, they've got great secondary engage with the Fizz or with the Rek'Sai or even the Nautilus Ultimate, but they're super reliant on, like, Fizzle landing or a hook. It's really not a good place to be in if you're CJ.
Yeah. Well, like we said, they really need to find those small skirmishes. They can't really do those big team fights.
Jin Erik also just going to be happy to kite right here. They don't have to engage.
Yeah, they can kind of play this same way they did last time.
Huge amount of poke. They outrange CJ substantially. So they could just sit at an objective and poke forever until CJ can't do anything anymore, and then CJ's just going to have to leave.
Oh, and Jin Erik, GBM is unbeaten on this Victor so far this season. So far, in general.
Yeah, interesting. He played a couple of games with it earlier. Let me pull up that stat, actually, to see what's going on with him and the Victor.
I'm a little bit surprised, too, that Coco's LeBlanc win rate is so low, man. It was like 36%. It's not a normal LeBlanc win rate.
He's had it banned against him so many times, though, also, if you remember.
Well, with his win rate, you got to wonder why.
Well, just because he hasn't been winning on it doesn't mean that he's not a threat on that champion. We don't know what a lot of the environments look like in terms of scrims, so let me...
Hey, man, this isn't solo queue until next match. I'm just kidding. Next match should be pretty good, too. Maybe a bit one-sided, but it'll be good. It'll be good. Well, speaking of one-sided, Shy is going to have a really hard time in this 1v2. Yeah, look at all the poke.
And this is going to be GBM's third game on Victor, so not too much of an impressive statistic so
far. Amazing statistics.
2-0. Wow. Oh, my.
That's incredible. I've got to have a champion that I'm 2-0 on somewhere. Amazing statistics.
Okay, well, it's like the lane swap going okay so far. MadLife's still in the top side, actually. Ambition maybe wanting to make a play. They just want to get the vein fed, apparently, so that they can win that lane.
Yeah, Trace going in now. Trace knows something's up as MadLife walks forward. And are they going to get the knock-up dredge line? Yeah, they get in onto him. Trace forced to flash, so they get the summoner at least.
Yeah, that's still going to necessitate another gank right now in order to actually do something with Chaser on a Coco right there. Gets the mark down, but gets chained, so can't follow up with the pounce.
Yeah, Coco just casually strolling away from that gank. That's the best kind of gank, you know. If you're being ganked and you just sort of walk peacefully away, it's not bad.
Certainly is not.
Yeah.
Unless you're the jungler trying to gank them, and then you just get angry, Doa.
Then it's just sad, yeah. See, you just got to play a jungler that can't happen on.
Vi every game.
Yep, Vi every game. Udyr, man. Just speed boost all day.
Well, you're going to miss a lot of ganks if you're playing Udyr.
Jungle Twitch, they never see you coming.
Chaser's here. He's going to be seen by the Tremor Sense. Shy. Dodge that right there, not too threatened. They don't know that Ambition's in that. Oh, now they do.
Yeah.
Do know that Ambition's in the brush now. Mark comes down, and it's going to be a push forward there for Shy. He's still going to get a decent amount of CS, however. And first recall coming in from Captain Jack. So the question is, pretty early, actually, to do that. Are they going to try and switch lanes right here?
Well, grabbing the pickaxe, and it looks like for now he's heading back down to bot. Yeah. Okay. So just wanting to get a little bit of a power boost to perhaps poke even harder against Shy.
That is actually surprising. So they don't see Maokai anymore. CJ was a bit confused there. They were trying to see whether or not the Lucian was going back into the bottom side, but Maokai was remaining top, so they committed to top, but they nearly went bottom. So CJ definitely still wanting to have the Vayne freezing in this top side for as long as possible, keeping her out of that very scary Lucian lane. But they're giving up a lot of dragon control for this. And again, Fizz really weak to dives. I feel that if Jhin'Air sets this up properly, they can really punish this Fizz pick early on, because his choices are don't clear the wave with E or try and clear it under the turret and then just immediately get dove.
Right. Yeah, once you use that playful trickster, there's really no more escape options aside from flash.
And I also just don't see a reason why you wouldn't fast push the tower right now. You went back, got the pickaxe, you have that extra damage. Go ahead, start putting the pressure onto CJ. Mm-hmm. Take out that turret and transition to an early dragon. I think this is definitely the best policy in this particular scenario. I mean, Shy hasn't even gone back yet. He has no combat stats.
Yeah, probably going to see things weigh a little bit more. Trace just tangling with space a little bit. The Space Trace lane.
So exciting.
Yeah.
That Vamp Scepter, he's just going to heal right up off the minion wave.
Yep. Just sucking the life right out of those minions.
So everyone's seeing each other with some nice early wards right there. MadLife just poking his head in, had the safety in order to do that, knew that Victor wasn't going to be coming from the mid lane to stop him.
Oh boy, I thought if MadLife maybe got down there far enough, they could have tried to blow up Che, but
no, Chaser was right there behind him. If they had gone in on that, they would have died 100%. And they should know that Chaser was around too on that side of the map because of the blue buff timing. So Chaser actually is going to come back in for one final pounce, and then hand it over to GBM's Victor. Takes it with the Q.
Yep. You got to have that shield, you know, in your backing, just for safety's sake. You never know when like an Ash arrow from another game will like come into yours and kill you or something, you know.
Nice protection on that pink ward, actually. So Coco not able to take that out thanks to Chaser's presence on the map. And that is really valuable. Ambition going to respond since he knows where Chaser is by taking the red buff in the top side of the map. But Chaser going to be doing the same thing.
Yeah, they will just trade buffs, it looks like. Oh, Captain Jack manages to dodge the dredge line from MadLife. Shy still trying his best to farm, but he's getting pretty far behind Trace as far as CS goes. Down about 13 at the moment.
And now Chaser coming around. And remember, Shy hasn't gone back to buy. He does have TP available. Will he actually make a play right here. They don't know that Chaser's there. It would be very dangerous for him to TP in, especially that Mad Life's zoned off the turret. Really good timing from Chaser to get there onto the tower. That's going to be a tier one killed, and Captain Jack going to get a near perfect freeze off of that as well.
Oh, not bad. Engineer already pushing through some of these lanes. So now that that's gone, it looks like they're going to go after Dragon here.
They see Ambition in the top side. They're going to take this objective for sure.
So where do you go after this? You know, where do you send Captain Jack and Che after this Dragon is gone?
Send him to a lane with another tier one and keep just turning on that pressure. Absolutely. You want to keep doing that. Bami Cinder now done for Shy. So he may have a little bit of a hard time in that lane. No armor yet. And they do trade that tower for tower. So looks like they're just going to farm up a little bit, try and deny Shy as much as they can, because Trace is actually getting that big, big minion wave in top. I mean, that was the tower went down, but they didn't have the resources to actually push the wave the other direction or push it all the way up to the tier two. So Trace is going to have a lot of additional farm off of this wave that Shy simply isn't going to get. That's huge.
Yeah, look at that. Already way ahead in gold.
Behind in levels, though, but that should even out shortly.
Shouldn't take too long, though. I mean, if you just sit with all those minions, yeah, you're going to get levels pretty quickly by yourself.
All right, Jhenair has a freeze on the tier two right now. They're going to be feeling very comfortable. Space is going to have to massively overextend in order to take this, and they guess they don't want... Oh, Shy. Recall delayed right there. Couldn't get too much off of that minion wave. Trace just continues to get all of this free farm in the topside. Space incredibly scared right now. They're trying to put down some wards. Ambition and Madlife really having to help out to break this freeze.
Yeah, I'd be pretty worried about it too. Can you dive this? Not with Chaser coming up. Looks like they might want to try though. They turn on to Chaser, they had that ward to see the flank coming in. Well, it looks like that ward's days are numbered. Gets taken out. Well, CJ at least able to put a little bit of pressure on. You know, despite getting that Maokai nice and fed, they were able to take one turret anyway.
Yeah, it's still a pretty bad situation for them because their composition just has so many troubles.
Uh-oh, Coco, speaking of troubles, goes back to the WGBM right there, flashes out of the gravity field. Coco forced to use that summoner to make it out.
That's extremely helpful for GBM in that mid lane.
Yeah.
One less tool that Coco's going to be able to use to try and take him down in the 1v1.
Oh man, the all-in potential, even though GBM doesn't have Ignite, seems to have just jumped quite a bit.
Yeah, it's... I don't know how CJ wins with this composition. They just have to individually outplay people with these skirmish-based champions. I just don't see it actually occurring. It's such a long shot.
Space goes Super Saiyan, becomes Super Space, level 3, and 1v5s over and over again. I mean, it takes about 30 minutes to, but you know, after you announce you're going Super Saiyan before you do become Super Saiyan, we know from the show. So if that fits in with the League of Legends timeline, game-wise, quite nicely.
Absolutely.
I think I've unlocked the whole strategy right there.
Well, they have to start shouting it in the booth right now then.
That's right. If we open the door, it's soundproof. So if we open the door, we could hear Space going, you know, he's like got his fists clenched, like little pieces of dust and debris are starting to rise through the air around him. Coco getting that passive popped, but no kill yet for GBM.
GBM looking really comfortable in this matchup and very comfortable on Victor overall. And GBM's just a player that's had such a large champion pool this year, going from a guy who could play very few champions and a lot of them were really out of meta to somebody who has such breadth. And that makes his Xerath picks even more confusing because you know he doesn't have to pick Xerath.
I don't know, man. I mean, he's got such a great champion pool, but and he's got so many of these meta picks, but he's still, there's something not quite right upstairs, you know, for GBM. He's like, I need to play this Xerath. I need to play this Yasuo. So he knows, he learns the good champions. He just doesn't play him. I don't know. Seems a little bit off there.
Well, that's one of the weird things about Jhenair, right, is that we know they're a good team, but sometimes they make it so incredibly difficult for them to win just based off of their perception of strategy that, I mean, I don't understand why they keep falling into these traps because from the outside, it really looks pretty obvious.
Yeah. I mean, they're like me when I want to like play one of the new popular single-player games, and I set it to like the hardest difficulty right away. I'm like, I'm going to conquer this. And then like 15 minutes in, I'm like, no, I should probably just go back to normal. That's how GBM is, you know. He wants to play it on the hardest difficulty, but you got to accept that sometimes it's more important to win. Ambition coming up. They're trying to save this mid lane turret and still taking a lot of damage. Ambition getting a bit locked up, gets very low. They're not able to hit him with the Chaos Storm. Wow, Trace comes in. First blood goes to Chaser anyway.
Yeah, Trace right there locking up Coco.
Yeah.
And then they were able to really easily just kind of
run Trace.
Bounce Coco in with the Arcane Smash straight into a Nidalee Spear. Well played.
Yeah. Nice to get that first blood gold onto Chaser as well, too, and get this Nidalee a little bit more jump-started as far as damage goes. And not a lot of wave clear, like you mentioned earlier. So Jhin Air able to take this mid lane turret pretty smoothly.
When Coco's dead, there is no way for CJ to defend turrets. Literally none. They have Vayne Fizz. This composition is just so bad from CJ that now they're just going to lose the entire map, basically, unless they can make some sort of crazy outplay or crazy picks. And given the quality of Jhin Air's vision control tonight, that seems really unlikely.
See, this is why we just need to stop talking about how we think matches are going to go. You know, we were like, oh, it's going to be close. So inevitably, it's a 2-0. We need to just be like, at the start of every broadcast, there's some matches today. We have no idea what's going to happen. Like, champions will be picked, games will be played, kills will be made, ganks will happen. It's about all you can expect, reasonably.
I don't know. It's just odd because CJ in the first game, I think, had a very good comp and then played it really poorly. And in this game, they just lost in draft. And okay, you got the red buff. They're going to try and trade it for a tier two in the top side. I mean, this is a good call considering that they need to get something done. Trace in trouble.
Oh boy, caught under turret. Tries to twist advance away. Nice arcane smash takes the damage. There's the ultimate from the Nautilus in space, able to pick up that kill. Nice turret aggro juggling as well, too. Nobody really taking a lot of damage aside from Ambition.
Yeah, but trading a dragon for a kill is nothing for Jhin Air right now. It's a much better trade for Jhin Air in the long run. They couldn't even get the tier 2 tower, but CJ just so desperate to make any kind of play at the moment that they just all pile onto the top side.
I mean, they got the kill onto space, but they're going to need a lot more than that to make this Vayne, you know, hard carry.
Well, this Vayne can't auto anybody because she's short range and Jhin Air will kite them and they have no engage. Mm. So in a 5v5 teamfight space, actually getting in range to auto someone who's not Maokai is really unlikely.
What if they made an item that made like auto attacks pierce? You know, go through and to hit everything max range? Wouldn't that be awesome?
So you would get in melee range and then shoot the backline?
Yeah. That's right.
I see limited usefulness to that
damage.
Item.
It's exciting, man. It's an exciting idea. In my mind.
The problem with that is that if you actually wanted to get use out of that, you would have to play in melee range of their frontline.
You know, it's too bad Annie didn't have her range that she used to. You could just go AD Annie and have, like, super long auto range. AD Lulu would be back in a big way.
Oh, jeez. Well, thank God. Well,
that'd be awesome.
CJ just trying to avoid Jhin Air right now and play where they actually have more people on the map. So they're basically just attempting to trade objectives while they continue to farm. But Space Chaser's right behind right there.
Oh, Captain Jack unloading a full culling onto Space, but Space flashes ahead, wins the duel, gets that kill. Chaser's right there. Chaser, oh, condemned away. Space, can he get the 1v2? Oh, so close. But Chaser able to finish him off.
That was nearly
a great play from Space.
That's basically what CJ has to do to win this game. Space isn't wrong to do that right there. You might as well just try and straight up outplay people because that's what Vayne and LeBlanc and Fizz are going to allow you to do. And that's the only advantage that they have.
It was a nice try, Space. A-plus for effort there. He got like 1 in 95% kills.
Man, this would be a pretty rough loss for CJ as well. If they lose this game, they won their last two, or they've lost their last two 0-2 each time.
Yeah, conversely, a very big win for Jhin Air as well, who has been traditionally struggling with the better teams in this league.
So there we go. And there's the Just a tumble. I mean, it's pretty straightforward. Does take the culling, flashes after Captain Jack, and just use that Vayne dueling power to win the game. And this one right there, there's a condemn. You see Space just trying to stay right on the edge of that Cougar range. Really close.
So close, man. Wow. You got to wonder if there weren't all those, if the minions had helped out a little bit more. I blame the minions.
Do you?
I do.
So you don't rage at your teammates, you rage at minions when you play solo queue?
Doesn't get me banned as often. Well, Captain Jack having to flee the bot lane as the flank comes in, perhaps, for CJ. Looks like they might get this turret. They want to get the blue buff, too.
I think that might be a little bit ambitious. And Chaser just going to leap in and help GBM take that with a smite. Really good transfer, actually, GBM picking up the buff.
Yeah, very smooth. Chaser has been very good on this Nidalee today.
Yeah, surprisingly. Yeah. I'm just not a big fan of the pick, but Chaser's been playing it so well that he's been making it work.
It's interesting. I mean, after Cinderhulk was nerfed a bit, it opened up the possibility of some of these junglers that were popular before the patch to come back, and we have seen a bit of Lee Sin, and now we're seeing a little bit of Nidalee. It's only a matter of time until Jarvan appears, Monty.
What's weird is that Chaser didn't play Nidalee pre-Cinderhulk.
That is a bit odd.
He only picked up Nidalee this season. You know, it's kind of strange, but...
On the other hand, that is a very generic thing to do, to be like, you know what, we're not going to play these meta champions. We're going to come at you with Nidalee.
Yeah, they really struggled in Cinderhulk as well, and but they're a team like the Koo Tigers that looks to have finally found their footing again after being hit hard by the patch. And of course, I say that, and they still are playing Xerath, so Coco actually going to get hit by the Twisted Advance.
Yeah, I think he's in big trouble. Passive pop. Shay comes in to try to chase him down. There's a nice whirlwind. Oh, dodges it with the distortion, but GBM gets the kill with the auto attack anyway.
Nice comeback on that, and Jhenair just playing a very measured game.
Yeah, they look very calm, very methodical today. Yeah, I mean, in both of these games, it was a little bit closer in game number one, but Jhenair never really seemed to be frantic at any point.
Indeed, they have not been, and now they're just going to use that poke advantage.
Well, like you said, with Coco dead, it's hard to defend this turret.
There's nothing they can do.
Yep. So much damage.
CJ has given themselves an opportunity to play this game with zero counterplay to what Jhenair is forcing on them at the moment.
Hard mode. Ultra hard mode.
Ultra hard mode, indeed.
Nightmare mode.
Well, Coco's back up now, so maybe they can save the tower. And yeah, that's going to prompt Jhenair just to go back. But yeah, taking a lot of damage on that turret. There's the dragon up in 15.
I was going to say, they can just grab this dragon on the way out, clearing some wards along the way. And CJ, you know, again, still not in a position where they can really fight this. Ooh, nice damage there.
Wow,
Did they not see that ward?
Nope, it was on the edge of the scanner range.
I guess so. Oh, well, Coco comes in for some poke, but gets poked really hard in return.
Not even worth it. GBM hit him much harder, actually absorbed some of that damage with the shield. So definitely not worthwhile. I'm sure they're confused as to how they were actually seen there, however.
A little bit. Oh, Shy coming down. Jhenair needs to be a little bit careful here, but they've already got CJ poked a bit. There's more coming in from GBM's Victor. Dragon doing some damage.
Jhenair doesn't have to start the dragon right now.
No,
they can just poke forever.
Yeah. And that's what they're doing. Let the dragon reset. Coming in, poking a little bit. And meanwhile, that mid lane turret might go down. Oh, never mind, they're going to go in. Ambition taking some damage. That does pull Space away from the mid lane turret, too. So by putting on that pressure, they do take some off of the mid lane. They're just going to go up and save the turret, prioritizing that a little bit more, I guess.
There's no pushing power on this CJ team. So basically, they set up a really long push right there onto the mid lane turret, which is just cleared instantly by a victory.
Yeah. Victory. That's what GBM has today.
Well, he's got one so far. Let's see if he can go for the double victory. And there we go. GBM gets jumped on.
Yeah, he does. Doesn't take a lot of damage because of that shield, though. Now starting to get a little bit low, though. Got to be careful. Culling comes in. A lot of damage done by Captain Jack. Coco very low as well, trying to escape here. A kill for Ambition, but a double kill, conversely, for the jungler on CJ. Chaser picks up a couple. Flash from Ambition to dodge that spear. Shy so low, you can't really do much about this. Space still decent health, but again, How do you get close enough to do damage with this Vayne? You can't.
You can't.
Yeah. So I didn't even need you to answer that one. I knew the answer to that one myself. You can't. There goes Dragon number 3 in favor of the Jhin Air Green Wings.
Yeah, Ambition now just pushing the top lane, doing all they can to take something for this. They realize that they've had pretty good side wave control this game. Gonna try and push that into the turret. Trace back up right now, though, and Victor already running to the tier 2. So it's just they get a small amount of damage now onto a tier 2 turret. Ambition going to come away with a red buff as well, but that's about it. And CJ Endes is playing much better this game. I mean, the fact that they've been able to stay relatively even so far and actually put pressure on cross-map objectives because it's the only thing their composition can do is impressive. But at the same time, it's just they're so far behind just after the draft.
You just know there's going to be a point, though, where Jhin Air is going to be like, all right, we're going to take Baron now. They're going to group up. They're going to poke out CJ. They're going to take it. And then unless a miracle happens,
holy cow,
objectives are going to go down.
Chaser is so rich as well. He had 2,200 gold right there. He's going to start working into a Luden's Echo,
yep,
just like last game. And the poke damage is absolutely insane. And there's not even a sign so far, not even a little hint, an inkling of an Aegis on the side of CJ.
Rumors on the wind of an Aegis
have been greatly exaggerated. No one's picking one up. And against the magic damage coming in from Jhin Air, that's going to be a pretty necessary item that is nowhere near completion.
Yep. And Trace getting understandably tanky as well with everything he's been able to acquire so far this game. Yomu was picked up by Captain Jack as well, too. I'm not sure quite how long he's had that, but it's a big item to get on Lucian.
Yeah, and it's just magnifying his poke damage.
Yep.
Absolutely perfect item to get with this team composition that they're running right now. Oh, boy. So Shy actually going to be going Cinderhulk into Trinity Force, but this is such an expensive item build on Shiv, or on Fizz, rather, that you're on Shiv. I was looking at the static Shiv on Space right there. But on Fizz, that it's going to be forever until he finishes it. Shy going to smite away the Gromp, but gets chased out anyway by Trace.
Yeah, I mean, you got to wonder by the time Shy is able to really do anything on this Fizz, if it's already going to be too late.
Well, Jhin Air, too. Look at this. They already have 3 dragons. I mean, the clock is ticking on that objective as well. And CJ, that means CJ has to engage them at the dragon, but they can't engage. So they can't really do anything. They need some sort of massive individual outplay, just colossal carrying from somebody to come back in this.
I mean, at least they've got champions that are capable of doing that. You know, Vayne, LeBlanc, Fizz, all champions capable of making those big, amazing plays.
Yeah, if they have items.
That does generally help, yeah, that's true.
Really need a lot more items in order to be able to do that. Captain Jack just going to sit there with heals from Chaser, so he's able to walk forward and clear that wave. Jhin Air just playing very, very patiently right now. Defending their turrets, making sure they can keep those up, and then they can transition later on into just winning the game off of Dragon. No need to be hasty. No need to overcommit. Just sit there.
Yep. Oh, Shy going in on a Trace, but Chase is right there as well. He's going to turn on ult on a Trace. There's a little bit of damage here. Shy is still in a lot of trouble. Gets taken out pretty easily. One last playful Trickster, and there's a kill for Chaser. Make that 5-0-0 for this Nidalee now.
Got 5 of his team's 6 kills. Now, that is a problem.
Yeah. Oh, boy. Captain Jack knocked up, but Che right there to help him out. Turret will go down, but the 2v3 chase is on. GBM trying to get there as well. He's just going to start that recall as Coco comes in. Captain Jack in a little bit of trouble. Oh, GBM cancels that recall, forces the distortion back from Coco.
It was a good play from CJ. They responded with 4 people when they knew that there were 2 on the bottom side, so a maximum of 3 on the top side of the map right there to finally chip down the last tower. But that was a lot of time for a tower that had like 1/6 the HP left.
Yeah, they were able to really get a lot out of that.
Chaser is so rich. Holy cow.
I wonder if he can pick up that Luden's when he backs here.
I think he must be really close.
1,400, nope. It's a little ways off yet, yeah.
He's trying to get a needlessly large rod before the next team fight, so that's why he's sprinting through the jungle right now. He really would like to pick that up.
Well, it's only 1,500, right? Or 1,600?
1,600,
yeah. So he could probably pick that up within a second or two.
If he had any camps that hadn't been cleaned out by Ambition, he would be able to. He's going to have to go for the top wave instead, but that's not going to be quite so good for him. Trace to Captain Jack going after Shy right now. Shy has to playful Trickster and ult to make sure that he doesn't get nailed.
Coco going after GBM, doing a little bit of damage there, but it looks like Shy getting caught yet again, taking out Captain Jack with a kill there.
Yeah, Trace flashed for that one, and after the playful Trickster's down on this Fizz, he's running Smite, so doesn't have any more movement summoners. That's it.
Pretty much. And now it's time for the Baron. With Shy out of the way, yeah, they find a ward there, but there's not a whole lot that CJ can do about this. They're going to try to put some pressure on. Jhin'Erik can kind of bait this all day when it's a 5v4, though.
They certainly can, and they should just go for the dragon right now. Get that number 4.
Yep.
Play safely. You're in a great position to do that. Shy has TP, but as long as you put down some of your wards.
And they are. Oh, Coco kind of off on his own, which is a little bit threatening because you can kind of pop over the wall and poke a little bit, but they have a ward. They know where he's going. Coco tries to come in from the side to do damage to GBM here, so comes a teleport from CJ as well. Everybody pretty grouped up. Madlife comes in. Captain Jackman should get the kill on Ambition, though, before anything really starts. Trace gets out with his life, and now Jhin'Erik just kiting backwards just like we saw last game. Got a kill, backed off a little bit, and if they end up needing to give up this dragon, which I don't think they will, they'd still be fine.
Yeah, well,
they don't even need to give it up.
Trace is just going to go back, and he has that TP. If he needs to come back in, he's going to use it immediately. He's going to try and cut off the exit, actually.
Teleport coming in, trying to catch people. Gets condemned back, though. Chaser.
Yeah, they see it back off. Just go for the dragon. No need to get extra kills at the moment. You're going to get what you came here to do.
Yep, that's right. Well, like you said, don't be hasty. They have to play it. They have to play what I call the Hobbit strategy, which is just stay home and farm. That works.
It's a good day. Yep.
No adventures for Jhin'Erik.
Well, they're going to have to take some sort of monster slaying adventure like any good Hobbit will at some point, though. They're going to need to kill that dragon one more time.
Eventually you do. Eventually you do. The B in GBM now stands for Bilbo, apparently. Gank by Bilbo?
You mean Gank Bilbo Mom?
I don't know if anyone wants to do that. I don't know. You never know. I won't judge. Either way, farming. That's the key. Farming and drinking elixirs, if you know what I mean.
Sure. Anyway.
I'm talking about beer.
Well, Gragas isn't in this game.
Well, he drinks like wine usually, though.
I think it depends on what skin he's wearing, actually.
Yeah, it's
champagne.
True. Sometimes it can be a keg.
Yep.
The
biker Gragas definitely has a keg of beer.
He definitely doesn't carry on. Might maybe box wine, but not a barrel of wine. Chaser gets grabbed by that dredge line, knocked up, a lot of damage. He's going to get taken out. A kill comes in for Coco. CJ got their pick. Can they get anything more? Coco comes in on a Captain J, able to poke a Captain Captain J. I don't even know what's going on anymore. I give up. I used it all up on that Hobbit thing.
All right, they're going to start the Baron. I mean, they have to do this. This is the one thing that they've got going for them, besides this great side wave control. And they're going to go in on it.
They're not going to try to allow this. They take out Madlife really quickly. Ambition knocked up. Coco trying to find some damage. Trace getting a bit low, but Ambition lower himself now. Space. Oh, gets very low. Taken out by Trace. And Jhin'Erik able to win that fight. Baron not really a big threat there. Getting a couple more kills. And now they can kind of do whatever they want. They can probably take out this tier 2 in mid if they'd like.
I think this has to be the worst team composition we've seen this season, Doha.
It's not. It just doesn't work.
It doesn't function. That was a 4v5. And you saw in the last fight, Ambition had already used his flash to get the Unburrow engage, which is a pretty bad engage in the first place. And in that fight, he could do nothing at all. Madlife just got destroyed instantly, and no one else was able to do damage. Space was in the middle of the fight, but the monsoon onto Captain Jack meant it was very easy for Jhin'Erik to clean up. Coco's just going to sit here and get soloed by Trace.
I guess Maokai can do that, huh? And so, empowered recall. A total recall, if you will. And Jyn Ayr.
Take a look at this. Remember, this is a 5v4, and they haven't taken that much damage. Mad Life goes down instantly. And then Captain Jack, look how there is zero threat on Captain Jack this entire time. He is standing within melee range of Vayne and Fizz.
Yep.
And they can't do anything at all.
Got that Bloodthirster now, too, so good luck, CJ.
I mean, he hasn't even had to build armor or armor penetration this game, because why? Why would he? Jhaya is trying to build a Trinity Force right now. Ambition is just going to get kited and killed by the front line. That's it. What other threat is there?
The threat of, like, their computers turning off in the regame.
That's about it. That is CJ's hope at this point.
Yep. Not exactly what you want to place your hopes in. They've got, like, Secret Agent Mach Noon back there, like, chewing on the wires, you know? We'll try.
All right. Well, now that there's a Baron up and the lack of wave clear is extremely real from CJ, they're probably just going to lose a bunch of towers. And to CJ's credit,
that was a very far twisted advance. Trace making it back. There is one inhibitor down and more sure to follow.
CJ has done such a good job this game of controlling the side waves. If you can tell that they're a good team, they just don't have tools to actually win this game.
Maybe they thought that Jyn Ayr was going to pick Xerath. They're like, we're going to pick a bad comp because we know they're going to do an even worse job of picking a mid laner.
No, they picked Victor in the first round of the draft on red side. They knew both solo lanes in the first round of the draft.
Naokai
Victor were the first two picks on red side from Jyn Ayr. There is no excuse.
I've got nothing then.
For this stinker of a composition that has come out of CJ.
Wow. Uh-oh. Well, Space is there as well, too. Condemns Trace into the wall. Trace follows up with that twisted advance. And meanwhile, well, Coco able to take this mid lane tier 2, but I mean, Jyn Ayr can kind of just keep pushing.
I mean, they are doing a good job. They took all three tier 2s against Baroned up Jyn Ayr. They took two of them against Baroned up Jyn Ayr.
It's been awkward, no doubt. I think Jyn Ayr is just tired of it. They're like, all right, we're just going to
Jyn Ayr is doing the right thing. Just ignore the split pushing because you know they can't possibly win with it and take their inhibitors.
And they can't really stop that wave clear. Fizz ult tried, attempted, missed. Oh, kill already on Mad Life. Tried to get him in from the side. Culling takes a big chunk out of a Shy and Space.
Oh,
Coco managed to get Captain Jack. Wow. Well, he's gone now. GBM took that kill, and it looks like this one's about over.
You know you're in trouble when you have to start thinking about flanking with Nautilus.
Yeah.
There's a Banner of Command minion as well, because nobody could take that minion out on the side of CJ if it's knocking on an inhibitor turret. They can take it out now, but...
Yeah. That's right. Well, I don't know. I feel like they picked the wrong support for CJ, because this game... It's certainly going to be not a loss.
Oh, God.
There you go. That was terrible, wasn't it?
Kill for Fizz. Die to turret right there.
Nice. That's fun. Oh, Mad Life grabs a Chaser with the dredge line. Let's play a game called Lose Our Baroned Up Carries and Then Delay the Game.
Usually, that's Najin's favorite game normally.
That's true, yeah. That's they've been studying at the OQ dojo of late game throwing, I guess.
Wow, and now they may actually lose this dragon as well, depending on how fast Captain Jack can hoof it. Coco's still in the base, though. Space not up, so it looks like they will get dragon number 5.
Oh, yep. Captain Jack should be able to get back in time.
This is a very puzzling series from CJ tonight.
It's getting a bit sad. It's getting a little bit... A little bit like I'm worried you're going to go home and cry into your pillow about this one here.
It's very odd. Certainly not up to CJ's normal caliber. They're going to try and they have to try and take this dragon. It's their only choice.
Well, it would be the fifth dragon for Jyn Ayr, so it is literally do or die for CJ right now. Culling comes in. Mad Life takes a lot of damage. Dragon getting low. Here comes Jyn Ayr. Can they get it? No, they don't. Shy picks up the dragon. CJ has to disengage. They got to get out of here. People are low. Mad Life on the run, gets caught by that twisted advance, taken out by Chaser, so enjoy your single dragon, CJ. It may be the last thing you ever do.
TP coming in from Maokai. They're going to catch a runner right here, either Shy or Space.
Yeah, right onto Space there. Space able to cleanse out of it, but the knockup comes in, catches Shy as well, too. Chaser and Che. helping Trace take out people on CJ. Oh, Trace very low, but Captain Jack right there for the kills. They're going to get the revenge onto Coco there. Wow, and Vayne, Space able to actually take out Chaser. So CJ, again, they're doing okay. They're fighting well, but at such a disadvantage. Double kill for Captain Jack, and this one's got to be over.
Yeah, they've got the super minions pushing it. They've got a huge minion wave in the mid lane.
Yeah.
They're going to use that Banner of Command and have it taken out immediately by Space, but it tanks enough to get the damage down onto a Nexus turret. Now they're trying to just kite back a little bit. They could take this last inhibitor. No need to. They're going to go for the Nexus, I guess.
Yep, that's right.
They have a Lich Bane.
Yeah, why not? Okay, here we go. Well, that helps too. That's a lot of burst onto Space. There's the ult from Che just to keep GBM healthy. Going to chase Shy back there a little bit. Madlife on his own is not going to win this game. Another double kill for Captain Jack. And Jin Air able to come in. And 2-0 CJ Entis. Pretty huge victory there.
Yeah,
GG.
Very nice for them. And this does answer a lot of questions. They got convincingly 2-0'd by KT earlier in the season. And while they did well against the lower tier teams, they lost just by a hair to the Ku Tigers. But now they bounced back. Resounding victory up against CJ Entis here tonight. And CJ, what was that?
I don't know, man. I don't know. Like, I've yelled, like, what was that about, like, good things that have happened, but I almost said it about, like, bad things this game. That was not good. That was not a good performance by our second-place team here in Korea. And the thing to keep in mind is that, yes, CJ is in second place, but, again, we saw their game score at the beginning of it. They were only +3, despite being
in
second place.
They're not in second place anymore.
Not